A bit about actually stakeholder democracy and what we mean by these concepts and the opportunities that are arising out of Rio Plus 20. As Hamish pointed out, after 20 years, there's still a lot of work to do. I mean, we are still in a situation where we are not fully accessing the processes that we're at here. We all know the issues, we heard about them this morning, we hear about them probably every day, and we have come a long way, but there's without a doubt a very, very long way to go. This is not by any means a perfect model of engagement. And we need to work very, very hard and to use all of our opportunities to help remodel these things in a very constructive way. There's no point in simply complaining about it. We need to begin to offer constructive solutions within these processes. You see throughout the document many instances the need to improve stakeholder engagement, but very, very little specificity about what that means in practice. And this is something that we're going to talk about now, and I'm sure we'll come on to many, many things. But basically, there's a very complex equation for sustainable development, but any decision-making process about stakeholder engagement. And it starts with principle 10, access to information. And I'm sure Joe will speak a lot more about this in a second. But information is an empowering agent. We really need to drive forward access to information and the ability to use it. It's vitally important. Information linked with education for sustainable development, equals knowledge. Knowledge will help define values. Values dictate and drive behaviors. And this is the only way we're going to reach sustainable outcomes and change our own behaviors and make the right decisions that we so badly need for sustainable development now and into the future. But it's important to bear in mind what are the building blocks, foundations of sustainable development. Good governance is without a doubt absolutely paramount and fundamental to sustainable development. It needs to be both many types, though. That is both multi-stakeholder as well as multi-layered. It needs to include everyone as well as working at all different levels, from the international down to the national, regional, and even local levels. Again, when we talk about sustainable development processes, but these principles, which I'm going to come on to in a minute, apply to any decision-making process. Whether it's about how you use a local forest to defining a process which is so huge and multilateral as Rio Plus 20 is. So to that end, we have written a paper, Stakeholder Forum, which looks at examples from elsewhere and from the past to define what are and still are good principles of multi-stakeholder partnerships. And I'll let Pat speak about this, but we focus a lot on the Committee for Food Security at the FAO. They've done some amazing work. They're very progressive. I encourage you all to sort of look them up, look at their own website. I'm sure Pat will give you a lot more details themselves. But I'd like to quickly just touch on what some of these principles are that we've distilled out. So that's with participation. Engagement must not only be between governments and stakeholders, but among stakeholders themselves. Grassroots engagement is of fundamental importance. Participation must not only include the more organized and well-funded organizations and stakeholders. You know, it's not just big NGOs, but it really does need to be the grassroots, the small farmers, the people who need to get here and be involved, because the decisions which are being made in their name also affect them the most. We need to ensure mechanisms for stakeholders to participate in formal processes and engage directly with governments and intergovernmental processes. Again, we have the major group process. We're allowed to speak at these things. Well, what does that mean? We need to really create formal processes which we can actually input in the final decisions. We need to involve combinations of stakeholders in the initial design and preparatory processes for any intergovernmental meetings. Again, we need to very carefully include the people who are going to be allowed to use these processes and design those processes. I talked a bit about access to information and transparency already. We need to ensure transparency in all processes and decisions by stakeholder bodies, particularly when representing constituents. That is, if we are here, the major group OPs are representing constituents, they need to be very clear about how they make decisions on their behalf. We need to ensure that the summaries of all meetings with key stakeholder partners and coordinators are made publicly available. Again, this is simple transparency. We need to be very clear about how we discuss issues and what decisions are made within these meetings. Not everyone's here. We should be very transparent about what goes on in these meetings. We need to provide all stakeholder coordinators with the same information, the same documents at the same time. As in legal process, it's vitally important that information is sent out to all parties proceeding in these decisions at the very same time, so at the same amount of time. Democracy, democratic processes, where possible, stakeholder representatives and coordinators should be elected. This is what the Committee on Food Security does, and it's been very effective. We need to identify and publish a set of criteria for the appointment of key stakeholder partners and coordinators. Involve stakeholders defining the selection criteria. Again, helping people engage from the beginning is important. We need to clearly divide constituencies and stakeholders into groups. And of course, we need to work on capacity building. We need to include training for people to engage in these processes. As some of you know, we do a lot of capacity building training with UNDESA for this process itself. And of course, it comes down to finance. We must ensure that there's trust funds to enable people to participate. It isn't just about the rich, well-funded NGOs. It should be about the indigenous groups and the farmers as well. That brings us all back to democracy and what we really mean. I mean, this is, of course, about participation. If good governance is the fundamental to sustainable development, then participation and access to information is fundamental to good governance. But with rights come responsibilities. Shedlin talked about it this morning in our meeting. I don't know if you were all there. But we need to obey certain rules and regulations. We need to understand what we can do and what we can't do. We're not allowed to speak out of turn. We need to be very careful and think about how we participate. We have the right. We must use it well. And of course, this leads to the point, if we don't get what we want, we can't get the systems we need, I said it yesterday on the other side of it, we need to be prepared for revolution. And I know this is a radical suggestion to say on the panel, but I'm very serious about this. Governments and decision makers need to understand that they can't just get away with anything. And we need to be willing to lay it all on the line and really go over it. They need to understand that if that's the case, we will do what we need to do. It's the only way we see fundamental change. They need to be aware of that. We are serious about these issues. So, call for good governance, and if you don't get it, I call for a revolution. I look forward to hearing your thoughts and the rest of the panelists.
Thank you very much.